Welcome to the Rob Call Bottom Up Show, sponsored by opednews.com, available on Pacifica Radio and Progressive Radio Network and iTunes and at opednews.com/podcasts and Stitcher. My guest for this show is Margaret Welty. She's an art professor at Folsom Lake College and was creator and host of the educational television series Art, Creativity, and You. Her website is margaretwelty.com, Margaret, W-E-L-T-Y.com, and her YouTube channel is Draw Here Now. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Rob. How are you today?
Great. So I'm having you on the show because we had a conversation about your passion for getting people to draw. And, you know, the problem is so many school systems are getting rid of art programming in the educational curriculum. And you have some serious concerns about that. So let's start off. How does removing art from public education affect our culture?
Well, removing art from our lives really is not good for us, because it's one of the ways that we can still easily use our hands and also be able to use our minds and make choices that are visual, not verbal. And when we activate the visual part of ourselves along with the kinetic and the spatial intelligence that it takes for us to move our hands as we used to do in so many other ways in our culture, whether it was hammering or stirring soup or washing clothes, we've kind of eliminated the hands and we can bring them back with the drawing. But in addition to that, we can bring back our mind and our creativity and start feeling some control in our life and feeling like we have some choice and that we have some individuality. We've lost our collective connection and we've lost our individuality that comes back when we start to make something that can only be made by us.
So when we stop using visual spatial brain functioning, which is a kind of intelligence that Howard Gardner has talked about in his multiple intelligences theory.
That's true.
How does that affect us, and how does it individually, and how does it affect our culture?
Well, one of the things that I think is that we are starting to see some hard evidence that when we only test for our IQ tests and we specifically don't test for what Gardner talked about with visual and spatial. He put them together, visual and spatial, and I buy them being together, and I'm starting to think that each of them needs to be explored even individually. I mean, they're always tied together when we use them, but the visual is so much about how we see the world, how we see ourselves, and that we begin to take back how we see things, because we're not teaching observational drawing at all in school anymore. We're teaching creativity, which is great, and making your own decisions, which is great, but we're not really utilizing our hands and our eyes with what's really real. And you see that in our politics, that we have no idea what's really real. We're able to be fed things that are very intellectual, or not even very intellectual, but they're very much mental things. So in this new information society, I'm old enough to remember back to when we started talking about, oh, we're going to an information society. Well, that's great. I mean, we love it. I love it. You and I are talking with all this technology, and we're talking and speaking with people today all over the world. So I love that. However, we shouldn't leave behind what got us here. And what got us here are our hands and our tools. And that's going back to like a physical anthropology and physiology history, that's what enlarged our brain. And they're starting to see that the brains are actually shrinking. And that's the last thing we want to do in education, is have what you would call a top-down mentality, where all the information flows from the teacher or from prepackaged ideas down, and the only thing that's supposed to come out of our hands is the right answer. So art opens it up so that there isn't just the right answer. It's your answer, and you construct it not based on what you're told to do. And that really is the difference in art. There's a whole area in the National Art Education Association now called choice art. And that's something, just to go on about this just a tiny bit more, that I realized about two semesters ago teaching my art in children class, which teaches pre-teachers how to teach art, that kids come to school sometimes and they don't make one choice. They don't sometimes make a choice about lunch. It seems that we don't even know how to make choices about our friends, about how we feel. And definitely we're not given art where we could, if it's taught in the choice art way, where it's not like we're all going to make this beach scene with this background and then we're going to put a horizon line, for instance, and then a palm tree, and we end up with some version of the same thing all the time.
Okay, that sounds like a really top-down way of teaching art that really doesn't engage the individual in terms of allowing them to manifest their own creativity.
You said it so great. It's absolutely top-down. And what has happened is not only do we not have art in the schools very much, although there is a resurgence of that now. The people that are going into teaching, they didn't have art in the schools. And they particularly didn't have what I'm talking about observational drawing, where you actually combine reality, pull that into you, and push it back out in the way.
So what you're describing is a new movement where there is choice art education for children. And I assume that could also be for adults too. But what does that mean, choice art education?
Well, it's interesting what it means, Rob. In some ways, it is a movement that, because it's just starting and it's taking hold as an organized movement right now, it's kind of radical in a lot of schools. Now, for me, I always had choice art in school. And when I didn't have it, even in elementary school, I was like, this is too project-oriented, meaning a beginning, a middle, and an end. So teachers that teach like I do, who are all over the country now, and we're gathering together with the choice art idea. The choice art is really going back to it, just like a lot of the things that you speak about how we're going back to the tribal society in terms of how we bring things up from the bottom, and then how that information informs how we are. So the choice art idea is that we quit saying to kids, we're going to make a this, and okay, I did this, now you do this, now yours should now look like this, and we kind of guide them through it, or have a model where we say, this is where we're going to go to. Now, these teachers aren't wrong. Our whole society is still evolving from when the artists were the only ones who could actually make pictures. And so if we wanted to see our own reflections, it was the people that had the most money who could hire the artists to make images of themselves. And then we started to open up and more people became artists towards the end of the 1800s.
You know, really, I'm sorry to interrupt, but it makes me think that, you know, a lot of art history was really about creating replicas of life. And if you go to an art museum and you look at art from hundreds of years ago, the artists were basically doing portraiture or landscapes, and it really wasn't until, I'm not an art expert, but it's really not that long in our history that artists actually changed from replicating what they saw to creating products of their imagination and modifications of reality. Which really, I think, is an important and valuable evolution of art, in that it opens up artists and the people who appreciate art to see things in different ways than they actually exist, which opens people up to seeing possibilities, really, rather than just seeing what's there. And, you know, when you think about top-down and bottom-up brain functioning, there's very little that 95-98% of the brain does top-down stuff, which means it takes in the raw material, which is the bottom-up, mm-hmm. and then it converts it based on our understanding, our analysis, our interpretation, and our filters. Mm-hmm. And what artists do is they offer us different ways to perceive the world, I think.
That's it. And that is what us making art affords us, because then we start seeing that even with our most basic way of using our hands with our own personal movement, we all even scribble differently. Most people think that, well, I scribble, you scribble, we all scribble, and we're all going to scribble the same. And in the very beginning of my art class, we all start scribbling, and then we walk around the room and we see that everybody scribbles differently. And so what you're talking about is how an individual too can see the world differently and then be happy about their diversity, their individuality, and not see themselves necessarily pulling away from the whole and not disconnecting, but having a whole new way of communicating with their peers, with their classmates, and so forth, that shows their individuality and allows them to appreciate everybody else's way of seeing and way of making.
But that makes me think about chaos theory. Because chaos theory basically has shown that out of chaos can come higher levels of order. And I love that concept. I've really embraced it for, God, probably 30 years or more, because it gives me hope that things can feel really crazy and chaotic, but out of that can come something better. And I think what you're offering is the idea that art can, and scribbling can, start out as something meaningless, but turn into something that really has great meaning and significance and maybe passion and maybe insight and illumination.
Absolutely. And we're kind of out of touch with our individuality at the most basic level, which is that we even move our hands differently than anybody else does. And when we get just to the basics, like kids did, of scribbling and making some kind of movement in the world that's recorded. So it's not a verbal recording, but it's even pre-reading in a way. It shows a baby human that they can actually make something that they can see, that another person can see. And so at the very basics, just in scribbling, which kids do, and they all, and along with that, they a lot of times make a line and they just follow that line. And so this is another thing with kids, is that they don't seem to lose attention when they make art, when it's choice art. They seem to be able to stay right with themselves for hours. Nobody can believe it. And they're not skipping from image to image the way they would be with video or with their phones. They're staying right there with their own creativity and their own making. And that makes them feel strong as a person, that they can make something that is reflected back with that to them, that they're continuing to watch and let grow. And so you see how this, at a very basic level, which can be picked up by any of us at any time, we start to organize ourselves better and organize our neurology better.
So how does this kind of an approach, which I love, I think that what you're describing is developing a stronger sense of self-agency within children and even adults, I would imagine. And that's so important to empower individuals to function in a cooperative, interdependent way rather than in a way where they are at the bottom of the hierarchy and basically told what to do and just being cogs in a big system where they don't have any agency and no sense of a role where they can make a difference. So what I'm hearing is that art has the power to help people to become aware that they can change the world, really.
I like that. Yes, it's true, because if you can't even make a decision on your paper, how are you even going to think that you can make a decision in the world? And with art, it's one decision after another. It's based on what's actually happening on your paper. So it is really empowering. And when you think about it, just on a family, friends, tribal level, we're missing out on doing a lot of things together in this society we have, where we all live separately and so forth. But if we make our own images and then we share them either digitally with friends, or we have art making parties, then we have so much fun. The thing I can't hardly believe, we're not drinking at the college, so don't anybody think that we have some new radical program at the college where we're drinking and drawing. That's that's for other places. I call them drinking and drawing, but it's usually drinking and painting programs. And people like it because they get together, but you can get together at home. And when we get together in the classroom, it is as if we are having a party once everybody starts creating on their own. And then we share and look around and have a chance to start this collaboration that you're talking about. A lot of times the students just naturally, because I let them speak with each other, there's many, many times, if not all the time in the classroom, if it's not being taught in a PBL way, which is project-based learning. And art's always been project-based learning. And I don't mean like, here's our project, we're going to make this product. I just mean that the project is that something's going to get created, and the process of creating is in and of itself just a very, very self-fulfilling and satisfying endeavor. So that's one of the things that I also teach, because the only way it becomes not satisfying is if you believe that you can't do it, and you believe that everything you're doing is bad, and you believe you have to know something from the top down somehow in order to do it.
So how do you change that? How do you fix that idea in people's minds that they're not artists, that they can't draw, that they can't create? How do you change the way they think about themselves and their relationship to art?
I just change it basically, you know, one scribble at a time. And one of the things that's become really important that I've come up with, it's a whole story that goes with it. There's a national art report card. It only comes out every 7 years, but it involves using multiple media to make a portrait. And so it starts with pencil and then goes to charcoal. And charcoal is a medium that most people don't use, and it's very flexible. It's almost like finger painting, because especially if you use this really kind of light charcoal, it's called vine charcoal. It's just get this like twigs that are burned, like things from the real world that just got burned, and that's it. And you can just put it down, you can take it off with your hands and smear it and just become very involved in it. Anyway, it has the charcoal, and then it has what's called oil pastels. And they're basically like oil paints that are sort of dried up. They're not totally dried up or they wouldn't work, but they're a lot like crayons, but they put out a lot of product and they're very colorful. And with that, I've added the nice new soft colored pencils and a little bit of medium. So now it takes it almost like to painting. So kind of a turpentine type blending thing. Anyway, the point of it is when you add a lot of materials and you add color, then people kind of get drawn into it. All right. And
systematically bring them more and more from pencil to charcoal to the more colorful media.
So absolutely.
Gradually, I mean, it's almost like desensitization for phobics.
Well, it can be that, because there are people that won't touch anything. And that's, you know, here's a society that...
Well, it's not so much, I'm sorry, it's not so much a fear of the medium,
It's
a fear of their letting go and of expressing themselves artistically because they're so self-judgmental. I mean, I used to be a therapist, and I would have people practice smiling, pumping smile iron. And I would send them home with smile exercises, and the hardest thing for them to do would be to smile at themselves in the mirror because they're so self-critical. And I would imagine that the self-criticism in trying to create art could be demoralizing and maybe even just stop them dead from doing it, really.
It does, and it does it over and over. It doesn't happen if people get on my videos on my YouTube channel, the Draw Here Now YouTube channel, because that's all about this meditative voice that I have that just encourages and encourages to draw. So it's like an art therapy thing that just says everything's okay. I reveal my own thoughts on, oh, I might do this and then I might do that kind of thing. And I also know where we're going in terms of taking you to where you could be the kind of artist that you want to be. But just like any,
what is that? Where are we going? Where are you taking people to in terms of being the artist that they could be?
Well, what I want them to know is they don't have to be any top name artists. They don't have to be Picasso. And just the other day, I found out that Picasso's father was an artist. So Picasso was not only born talented. I try to get rid of this myth of talent, because why should everybody have to be predetermined by someone else to be talented enough to do something that's enjoyable? This is a ridiculous concept. And so many people are just looking with their kids for how they're going to turn up as a genius, or who in the family. This is another problem psychologically, is that somebody's identified them as the artist, another person as a musician, and there can't be any crossover. So I really tell people that they can do it, and it's worthwhile to do it no matter what happens. And people do like that I am an art professor, which I think is kind of a top-down term, just so you know. But I'm really just somebody who said, hey, developmentally, you haven't been through your developmental stages. And this is something I watched when I taught my drawing classes and the art and children classes, which are art classes for how to teach art to children, is that people just hadn't been through their stages. I just kept backing it up further and further, because it was my charge I gave to myself that anybody that came into my classroom needed to go out able to draw, and as you're saying, happy about what they're making, not still feeling like less than, never can, and they don't want to do it. I want it to become, to answer your question about how we'll become, I want it to become part of our daily activity. I want it to be like, okay, I'm freaking out. Like my hairdresser, she keeps art in her car all the time. She keeps pencil, paper, whatever, we always say pencil and paper, but it can be colored pencils, it can be marker pens, it can be anything. And when she wants to reconnect to herself, she just starts drawing, even if it's at a stoplight. So it's something that's obviously non-toxic. It's only toxic if you think you're terrible at it. And so coming from this art professor place, it really makes sense to some of these people, like as a little halfway house, is that she says I can do it. And if she says I can do it, because I'm used to people telling me if I can or can't do something, then I guess maybe I could try. And then she has a method which takes me back to my early stages and helps me go all the way through them and develop my neurology so that I develop my art brain and my art body. And that's the only thing, is we haven't done that.
Okay, so we're going to talk about that in a minute. First, we need to do a station ID. And if you're on the video, you already know about it. So I'm going to have a pause so I can quickly find this when I'm editing, and then we'll do it for the radio. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then I'll be getting a
pause. Link. Pause, no sound. And my guest for this show is Margaret Welty. She's an art professor at Folsom Lake College and was creator and host of the educational television series Art, Creativity, and You. Her website is margaretwelty.com and her YouTube channel is Draw Here Now. So tell us, how do you get people started? I mean, and we've got adults listening to this. How do you get adults to start drawing on a regular basis and make it a habit as part of their lives?
Like everything that they talk about in habit theory and habit change and so forth, it has to be something that you start doing over time. And it's really a lot of what you're talking about, Rob. They have to turn off the critic and just say, hey, you know what? I'm going to just do art for art's sake. I'm going to do it because it's good for me. I'm going to do it because it doesn't have side effects like some other methods of changing your mind or chilling out.
Like drugs.
Well, yeah, like drugs or like alcohol or like any of the other things that we reach for when we're feeling hopeless and helpless. And so when we are depressed, and then even if we're not depressed, we can do something that makes us happy at home, in our car, pulling over by the side of the road, drawing a tree. And I have all these different ways of showing people how to do it. And you've got your top down, like, eh. That's good, but also let's do bottom up. I've got, let's draw from the center out. And that way we don't make mistakes and we don't try to do something that's way beyond what we could do, which is go to this whole perimeter thing that we're so obsessed about in our...
I don't understand.
Well, most people draw, like the coloring books, they're going to have like an outline for per, you know, let's say for the rabbit. Okay, so you're going to have the rabbit ears, you're going to have the nose, and, you know, you may have some kind of fur. And this was all drawn by somebody who was an accomplished artist that made the coloring book.
And so somebody else creates the perimeter or the outline, and then you color it in.
Yeah, you do. You fill in my idea. And then you think, as a little kid, you like coloring. Oh, coloring was drawing. No, coloring wasn't drawing. Coloring was filling in somebody else's drawing.
So you don't like coloring books?
I'm not against them, because anytime somebody goes to that place in their mind with color and they start filling in and they feel good because they do it, I'm the last person that's going to say you shouldn't do that. And I'm the first person that feels so... bad that leaves them with no hope. And what I've done is created a method over 20 years where I can take them through their developmental stages. And they, you know, if you make a scribble, if you just would, you know, like make a scribble, like just pick up a piece of paper and a pencil. And if I had something that was a little bit juicier here, I'd have a whole bunch of scribble on it. I'll go ahead and make it like that. And I could fill this thing in with color myself. You know, I wouldn't have to get a coloring book, but then it wouldn't look perfect. Okay. And we have this obsession with perfection.
And self-criticism, which you said you help people to get rid of. So how do you help people get rid of self-criticism and perfectionism?
I first have to develop trust with them, because they're never going to, you know, you've been a therapist. They're never going to let go of it unless you develop trust with them. And I think that the YouTube videos make people see me. They don't actually see me on them. They just see what I'm drawing so far. And so I just show them my method. I share with them. And my method, I used to hate even calling it a method, but my method is that we're going to basically... make art from the bottom up. We're going to go to where we were when we were a child, and we're going to have fun with it. And we're going to clear, and I just say it over and over. We're going to clear our criticism. No, it's okay. It's okay to make art. And in my art class, where I teach the pre-teachers how to make art, we go through a whole thing, which I probably should really make it so everybody can go through this. And that is that we discover what I call it our art story is. And if we have a negative one, which 99% of the people have what I call their train wreck, where they had some teacher or parent or kid tell them that, why are you scribbling? Scribbling's for babies. Or why are you drawing when you can't draw? There's a great story I have of one of my students drawing over at the Museum of Modern Art in San Francisco. And they're supposed to go there and then draw from the center out. I give them a lot of instruction on how to look at something and see where the center of the picture is, and then the center of their paper and so forth. So a lot of help. And I don't, I make it step by step, so we don't leave anybody in the dust. In my teaching, I never ask anybody to do anything they couldn't do. So I link what you can do today with what you'll then be able to, I can ask you to do tomorrow, the next day, and the next day. So it's totally developmental. So here's my student. She's around 40 at the time, and she's there at the Museum of Modern Art, probably picked like someplace in front of a painting where she could sit and do this painting, draw it on her pad. And some, I want to say, well-meaning person who probably always wished they could draw, kind of come, who's very much kind of a member of the museum and museum community is the way I always saw this. And she comes up behind her, and she sees what she's drawing, and she says to her, why are you drawing when you can't draw?
Oh my God.
I know. It always hits everybody, because that's what we're all afraid of, because drawing is revealing. You can't make an invisible drawing. But my student says to her, I'm willing to be bad to be good.
Mm-hmm. That's beautiful.
I was never
really, so in any field, any attempt at art, at any skill, at any profession, you have to start out being bad in order to be good.
Yeah, I say everything I can do is easy for me, and everything I can't do is hard. And that's just the reality of it.
And the fact is, anything you're going to get good at, you have to work hard at. You have to fall down. You have to make mistakes in order to get better at it. And then the better you get at it, the easier it is, the less work it is.
And that's what we could be teaching by teaching art in the school. because one of the things that great art teachers, and there's been great ones all along, it's just we want to really have many, many more great art teachers say, is you can't make mistakes in art. But it's not because you have the right answer. It's because you know how to turn everything you're doing into something productive for you, not for somebody else.
I love that. That's beautiful.
And
the opposite of it is these people who come along and say, why are you trying to do this? I think these are kind of authoritarian people. They're people who can't handle the open spaces. They can't handle the allowance of creativity. Because, you know, in a sense, art and creativity open people's minds. And when you open people's minds, you open them to revolutionary ideas, really. And in a sense, art is revolutionary if it allows creativity. I don't know that the kind of ultra-realistic art does that for people. I'm not sure. Maybe, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, it's a slippery slope on that, because I feel that everybody does want to be able to draw realistically, but everybody's version of realistic needs to be their own. And on their journey to having the choice about drawing realistically, people really want to have the choice that if they wanted to draw a flower the way they see the flower, they'd love to do that. And one of the things that you were interested in me speaking about with you is how art changes how we see the world. So right. We're talking about how art changes how we see the world and feel about the world psychologically, and how it opens up our minds for lots of different possibilities. We see that we could compose and change things in a lot of ways. It's also really important that when we go so viral and virtual with reality, that we also still understand reality, that we touch the world and that we see the world. So I actually teach touching things. So I would teach touching like the top of this cup to understand how to see it, because otherwise all our minds have been pre-programmed with what I call clip art. So we go to draw something, we see a flower, and so we think, oh, I'm going to do a flower, you know, that's more like a clip art, not what I'm actually seeing, where maybe like a petal's coming at you. How do you draw that? Or a hand's coming at you. We all have that in our head. But what if we encounter something that's really different, like how my hands are really different right now? Then how do we respond to that? Well, that takes the training that we're talking about. Now, that doesn't mean, like, I'm an artist and I like to draw in an awkward way. You know, I drew 50 portraits a day at Disneyland. So obviously in 7 minutes, I can get a profile of a person down in pastels and then rip it off, give it to them. They can take it home and hang it up. So that's realistic, but those skills I use in a variety of ways, and I encourage my students to. So you want to have that kind of range, you know, like no matter what kind of speaker you are, or no matter what kind of writer you are, we're now seeing that you can write differently. This person has good writing skills, let's say, and they've broken maybe out of some of the boxes that we were taught in school of how sentence structure has to be and that type of thing. But you still want to have a grasp, literally a grasp of how you would do that, and then how you would take that and do whatever you want.
And I guess when you learn how to create ultra-realistic paintings, you've got to learn all kinds of perspective. You've got to look at the foreground and the background, the gestalt. There are all different aspects in creating that ultra realistic painting that make you see with new eyes, really.
Absolutely. And one of the things I think you and I can probably agree on here, I'll talk about it in terms of art and you talk about it in terms of bottom up, and that is that we've lost context. So when you mention foreground and background, I have students that only see the thing. Just like when they're little kids, they show them like a picture of a cow, which is not a cow, and say, what is this? Oh, good. Let's put the word with the cow. Okay, now let's say what the cow says. Oh, the cow says moo. Well, if you've ever talked to a cow doesn't say moo the same way you might say boo. no cow says moo, and no cow looks like this image on the picture. So coming into really being able to see something, digest it, understand it, and literally touch it. We're losing this whole thing about touch. So we're also losing ground. And I mean, you know, I like my metaphor, and I know I'm speaking to somebody who'll like it, and that's that we've lost the middle ground 100%. So my students only see the thing. They only draw one thing. They plop it anywhere on a piece of paper. They've been doing that since they were 8, if in fact they actually draw something fairly realistically, or they copy somebody's, which I'm all for copying. But I also think introducing reality, so you can tell if the emperor's wearing clothing or not. You're not just being told that the emperor is dressed. It's like, you know what? Like a little kid. No, not dressed. Naked.
So talk a little bit more about how getting rid of drawing affects our culture and how adding it affects our culture.
Well, one of the things that I think about is just what it would have been like if I went into one of those caves where they discovered the cave drawing. And I've tried to envision that. And envisioning that, I realized that it's a form of communication. And it's a form of deep meaning expressed. So if we put art back in the schools, all the things I'm talking about, hand-eye coordination, being more tactile, pushing out who I am, my art. I had a little kid one time, one of my students, she was on the phone when we used to be connected to the wall with our phone, and her little kid was screaming to her, showing pointing at his own art, and he was like, "To my art," he says. And that's what we all want to feel like. That's my art. I exist. I made that. And when you put the work up in the room, you don't really have to teach a whole lot of diversity because you have diversity, and you haven't homogenized everybody into two eyes, a nose, and a mouth.
And I think that another thing that art does is it teaches relationships and connections.
That's so great. It absolutely does. It's in all my classes, I want community. And it is about relationships and it is about connections. And one of the things I've been hit by this last semester is one of my students' grandfathers has Alzheimer's. And he is so excited about making art with her now. She wants to become an art therapist anyway because it communicates, back to the connections, it communicates. He now has a way of communicating. His verbal brain is kind of shut off. I mean, he can speak and so forth, but the way he relied on that part of his brain is now not reliable, but his visual brain is, and then his making brain is, and all of a sudden he exists in a dimension now that he is alive with. And we don't have to like lose our bottom down to create, our top down to create our bottom up. And when we have this bottom up, we start getting these relationships again.
What you made me think is, somebody who has been impaired in some way and who finds himself by creating art, really, when we take away art from people, we're taking away a part of who they are. We're shriveling down to nothing, a dimension of your humanity that is a loss. And you know, one of the things I've been excited about in putting together my book, Bottom Up: Tapping the Power of the Connection Revolution, is the idea of Darshan Narvaez, who did this book that really got me excited, The Neurobiology of the Development of Human Morality. And what she talks about is how there are literally hundreds of genes that evolved over millions of years as humans were hunter-gatherer bands. And those genes are not fully expressed since civilization, which is top-down, came along. And that means we're a bit less human than we evolved to be. And what I'm hearing,
we're slipping. We're not top as humans. We're slipping without those genes being expressed.
And so, I would imagine that there are genetic aspects of ourselves. The epigenetics. Mm-hmm. Epigenetics is how our genes are expressed or not. Mm-hmm. I would imagine that art helps us to allow some of our genetic propensities and potentials to be really fulfilled and flourish and blossom rather than be repressed.
Okay, that is beautiful. That is how I feel about it. That's my 25 years, much more than 25, because I started teaching art in the classroom in high school because the teacher had to be kicked out at third grade and they couldn't find a person to teach the one art class he taught.
That's like when I was in high school, they did a movie about my high school called High School that was banned in the city for decades because they went in saying it was going to be a kind of a documentary on a typical high school, and it basically showed how terrible teaching could be. And I had a teacher, an English teacher, who read poetry in a total monotone.
We now know that person was on the spectrum, okay? We all are different, you know, but you are totally right. Teaching can't, and so when I taught in the high school, I mean, they gave that class to me. I know somebody that lives in San Francisco remembers when they brought me in at 17 and said, this is your new teacher. And so I did that and I loved it. And I was totally choice art then. And I was great when I got hired 20 years later to teach color theory. And I was still great when I was teaching painting because it can be so expressive. Again, both of those have color. And then the minute you drop down to a pencil these days, and that was even almost 30 years ago, then we don't have what we used to have, just like what you're saying. We've lost it. The handwriting has turned into hand printing, which is just this grip that people have on this tight grip, and they try to apply that then to drawing, and it just doesn't work. You know, we've just pulled everything down a lot in, you know, to what can be tested. And we do lose our expression. I mean, to take it like you just did, down to we're losing the expression of our genes. How can we get that back?
Let's talk about that in a minute. Let me do a station ID now. Again, I'm going to pause for the video. So when I do the audio editing, it'll show up as a pause and I can find it fast. And my guest for this show is Margaret Welty. She's art professor at Folsom Lake College and was creator and host of the educational television series Art, Creativity, and You. Her website is margaretwelty.com and her YouTube channel is Draw Here Now. And we've been talking about how the adding of art affects ourselves and our cultures, and how taking it away and eliminating it from the school curriculum is affecting us. And what I'd like you to talk about now is how can the viewers or listeners to this show start putting more art in their lives?
I love that, because one of the answers I have to art not being in the schools, it doesn't mean that art can't be in our lives. And so I've tried to make a method that is supportive of the individual doing this and supportive of groups getting together, making your own groups. That you have a potluck and then you're all going to draw, or you have an evening with your family and all the art materials come out. And I do encourage people to get different materials and experiment with them. And that's the problem. And you mentioned it, you know, people don't really understand how to go about making art. And one of the things I say is that this in the schools, because it has to fit into the time in the schools, and it has to fit into how we can store the art and if we can make a mess and all that kind of stuff, which are not limitations in your own life at home. In the schools, we give kids one piece of paper, we tell them what the project's going to be, and that we're going to do it, let's say, in an hour. So I call it the one piece of paper, one project, 1 hour way of going about something, which really leaves you out of it. So you want to start putting you into it. And one of the easiest ways to do is to get some art materials, go ahead and feel scared. We all do. My grandparents gave me a box of pastels that are pretty much still untouched because it's like, I'd have to know how to use them. There must be some way to do this. There must be a right way. There must be a wrong way. It's a scarcity thing. I haven't had art materials before. And so we want to just dig in. And really, if you've got a kid around and you put these things in front of a young enough kid, they are going to show you what to do, which is that you take whatever you have and you make marks with it any way you can. What? And then you say, yay, you know, because you are a baby. You're like a toddler. You're like a kid that's learned how to roll over and now push up and now stand up and maybe now hold themselves up. And then what do we do when kids start taking their first step? We don't tell them, you know, you suck at this. you know, you should see your grandfather. He is really good at walking, and I really don't think you should walk, you know, because you're not showing evidence of being able to do this. So, you know, I failed swimming at age 6. My mom had to pull me from it. I was totally scared of that water in that pool with that instructor. In high school, I set 3 national records one day in swimming. Okay, if we're determining who we're going to be at age 5, it's ridiculous. If we determined who I was going to be when a friend of mine who had a big crush on, you know, watched me swim at the river, because I always swam underwater. And so I had all the misconceptions about swimming, that it was more like some kind of a paddle wheel affair. We need instruction, but we now can get our instruction in our own home on the YouTube channels. And there's a lot of good stuff out there that's not just my stuff. My stuff slows it down to your speed. We never speed up what I'm doing. The only time we do is sometimes when we're going out of a video, we'll speed it up. But how can somebody watch these speeded up things where people don't tell them exactly what they're doing and don't have an attitude like anything you do is great? And that's the attitude we have for little kids when they're learning to walk. And you want to have that same one for yourself when you're learning to draw and a kid isn't thinking like, I'm hopefully going to be able to pole vault someday, when they're just trying to walk. And you shouldn't be thinking that either. Oh, I want to make these big paintings and then they're going to sell for thousands and millions of dollars. That's not what it's about. It's about you having an art journal or paper around, even when you're just brushing your teeth. If you just have a little set of watercolors and you just do a little bit of putting water onto a piece of color, watercolor paper or any paper, you're going to sleep better. So there's so many.
What would you recommend that somebody get? I mean, and what do they have in their house already? And what would you recommend that they buy as first steps towards getting more involved in putting art into their lives, creating art?
Well, you know, we have art stores that I really do think it's good to go to art stores if you have them in your town. And if you don't have them in your town, you can get anything. Like if you don't mind getting a little messy, you can get this stuff that's called vine charcoal, or any of the charcoals. You could just start working in charcoal, which would change your medium. In some ways, I think anything is great. But by changing the medium, that's good. If you can relax like a kid can about watercolors, not looking like the most amazing, astounding watercolors you've ever seen by accomplished artists the minute you touch your paper, you can get any paper, but especially watercolor paper is nice, just a cheap pad of it, and then a little set of watercolors, maybe a little bigger set of it. Because of the coloring book craze, Amazon has all this stuff, especially like, I like the oval, it's oval 16. It has a bunch of different colors in it, but even what they call the oval 8 in just cheap, you know, these are kids. Crayola has this stuff. This is cheap stuff. And then I always think though, a good brush. And so a brush that springs back. One of the reasons we're unsuccessful with our watercolors is they used to come with the most horrid brush. Now they come with a better brush, but lots of times it's good to get something that's a bigger brush that either comes to a point or comes to more like a square, but it's tapered down. And so, you know, a mid-level brush, you don't have to spend a lot of money.
Or a set of brushes.
Pardon me?
Or a set of brushes.
Or a set of brushes. They have nice set of brush packs that are like maybe $12, $15. And then you can experiment. The whole idea is to get something and experiment with it and not be thinking about what your outcomes are. Just the outcome is that you're happier because you have color. So you can get pastels. You can get the oil pastels. A lot of people like that. I didn't really like them until I started using, and there's 3 videos I have up on Draw Here Now that are based on the seminar that I gave at the California Art Education Association, their last meeting in San Francisco. And there's 3 on there that are connect, create, collaborate. And they show these materials that I'm talking about and different ways to use them. And all of my stuff that I start with is either abstract, meaning that it's non-objective, it doesn't show objects necessarily, or it shows you how to even just cut apart a leaf and trace it, start doing your own tracing. So almost any way that you start to access is the right way. There isn't a right way or a wrong way.
So a couple things. One, why would somebody go to an art store instead of ordering on Amazon?
Just because they could touch it and talk to a real person that might ask, you know, might have something to say. I know we have a good art store. We have several good art stores where I live here in Sacramento, but you don't have to, as long, you know, you don't have to. It's just, if you live someplace, and art stores aren't every place anymore. You know, sometimes I know in the little town I lived in the mountains, that their old-fashioned newsstand had art materials. And then some of the box stores sometimes have art materials.
I would imagine that art stores, some of them will offer programming and teaching and courses and workshops.
Some of them do, and some of the museums. Our museum here in Sacramento, the Crocker Art Museum, has a really good education department, and you can pick for different courses. I usually recommend those. I look at those, and I'll be teaching one of those soon. So, you know, there's a lot of it, but you really want to, you want to make sure there isn't somebody who's telling you, oh yeah, I can do this, I can teach you, but I haven't broken it down for you. And most important, I'm not starting where you are, because you do want to start at the bottom, because you're at the bottom. In fact, I take even my better students and take them all the way back to scribbling, so we can rebuild the neurology and the hand-eye coordination all the way back up through it. And the concepts
reminds me of a friend in college who played the trumpet, and he didn't have the correct embouchure, which is the way you hold your lips. And he, in order to correct it, he was going to have to stop playing for 6 months and then start over again.
That is kind of why we go to scribbling, and why the other thing about scribbling is you're connected to the paper. So two things. I'm very much about us staying connected to the paper when we're working. You don't get to do that quite so much with a brush, because you have to reload the brush and so forth, but still that's good. But if you can do some things just with a pencil on a piece of paper. But one thing I'm going to say is that you need to not hold the pencil the way people are holding their pencils now. They hold like this. They wouldn't even really be able to see what's underneath it unless they get their head down on the paper like this, like a lot of them are. And I think actually, let's say one little radical thing here, that our schools are so difficult for kids right now, with so many kids in the classroom and stuff, that in a way they've been taught, well, they've just kind of pulled themselves in like this and made kind of a little fortress as best they can in their little place. So everything's kind of little. And when you go to drawing, I want you to hold, to change this from this writing grip and being in your verbal brain to going out as if I handed you a paintbrush. So I often tell the students, paint on me. Just change your grip. You cannot be drawing like this. This is not a way to draw. It's a way to possibly print.
So I'm holding my pen like this. This is how I hold my pen.
That is awesome, because you learned cursive when you were little. You learned how to write on the paper in a connected way, and it never came up off the paper. Somebody said they wrote a letter to their kid at camp. Just saw it on the internet the other day, and the kid said, "Dad,
I
couldn't read that."
Creates a different kind of connection to the paper than printing does.
Right. Printing
is certainly different than typing does. Mm-hmm. So just the act of cursive writing creates a fluidity and a sense of connection that is real. I never thought about that. That's fascinating. And I want to get into connection a little bit more, because we're getting close to the end of the interview. And you mentioned connection and cooperation. And I know that one thing that's developing is a kind of a bottom-up aspect of art that's emerging is cooperative art, where people connect together and they do things together. I had a guest who created a composition with different parts, and then he made it available to people so that they could create their own YouTube of them singing, and then he wove together thousands of them all into one composition, and that's, it was amazing, really. And I'm wondering, are you doing anything where you get groups of people to cooperate together in creating art as a group?
Well, we just, in my art and children class at Folsom Lake College, one of the they work together as a group to make a class presentation so that they don't have to just go it solo when they first present to the class. So they collaborate and cooperate into making a process. And one of the most successful ones where they had all kinds of fabric, and I think they even had like glue guns and glue and sewing. They tried to introduce some of these hand arts and so forth, but they had these squares. And then they cut it, they cut like tabs on the edges of the squares, and everybody made their own square. And then they were all tied together to make like one big quilt. And so I have a picture of that, and they gave me the quilt. And so it's everybody's little piece that were, each of them were about this big, and then they were all knotted together. And just the, it was like a quilt, but I love the fact that they were actually tied together.
And working together and creating with the intention of creating a, something that was a collaborative process.
Right, it's bigger than the, each individual.
My friend in Chicago, Margot Rush, has an art, a community art place, Ogi, where she recently had a commission to do a mosaic where an artist created it, but then she had 10 students from the community create the pieces and put them together and literally learn how to cut the tile. And I love that concept of the whole community coming together to create the art, even though it's a bit top down because one artist created it. And because tile can be so expensive, it might be a challenge, a more challenging, risky process to create it as they went. Maybe that would be their next step.
I wish I had this man's name on the tip of my tongue, but he's an artist in Seattle, but he makes work all over the world. And so when I was at the National Art Education Association meeting in Seattle, he did a presentation, and he showed how he reconstructed this tree. So it is an artist's vision, but it starts with a tree that came bottom up out of the ground, and it's a huge tree in Seattle, and they went and made out in the forest and so forth, and they made plaster casts of this tree. And then, long story short, they then bring that back in to reconstruct it, not out of the plaster, but the somehow different things that they make. You'd have to see the whole video, but he actually opened a store, like a studio on the street, and people from the street could come in and work for a couple of hours on making this, the tree's huge, on making parts of the trees. So these community projects, which we know as maybe like quilts or murals or things like that, can be thought of completely differently. And then this whole thing goes to a museum, and then it gets shipped someplace else. And then eventually he wants to take it back into the forest and let it decompose, because it's also, of course, green and sustainable.
Cool. I love the idea of going beyond just the usual murals on walls, which I think is great. And yeah, there are, you know, I'm in the Philadelphia area, and Philadelphia has more than I think any other place in the country or the world in terms of murals created on the walls of buildings. But it's usually somebody or a group is commissioned to do it. And the idea that a whole community would come together to do it, like they're doing at OG, is just really cool. And I think that to make that happen, you need to be politically connected. You need to have the people of the city or the community help to fund it, help to provide the space for it, help to support the creation of it. I know at OG, there was help from, I'm blocking on, what do you call the local people?
Artisans?
No, it's politicians.
Politicians.
But there was a local politician who was helping to, I mean, literally feeding the kids who were working on the art. And the owner there was an owner of a building that was allowing the building to be used for that function. And I think that's an amazing thing to do too. So really the community needs to come together, not just artistically, but financially and resource wise, to make it all possible.
And those things are starting to happen. Just, you know one off in the top of your head. I know one. 30 years ago, I made a huge piece that was 55 feet wide for the Sheraton in Inner Harbor, Baltimore. And six people helped me make that. And that was very controversial back then, even though it shouldn't have been. The piece wasn't controversial, but the idea that the artists would not alone by themselves, you know, these are all these things that people have been told to me.
Silly thing. We've got a wrap. It's been a great interview, and I really appreciate it. Any final words?
I think that it's time to, if you want to, go to my YouTube channel to art, to make, to draw here now, so that you can draw here now. You can start finding out about art materials and so forth, and bring art into your own life, and don't wait for the schools or anybody else to bring it
All
to
right.
you.
And you've been listening to Margaret Welty. She's an art professor at Folsom Lake College and was creator and host of the educational television series Art, Creativity, and You. Her website is margaretwelty.com and her YouTube channel is Draw Here Now. Thanks so much, Margaret.
Thank you so much, Rob. It was a pleasure.